So we're from the Milwaukee area. Okay. And I know our friend at hospital there. My husband had cancer on his phone. It was funny. It was very interesting, you know, watching everyone's in the light poles.
I think she's doing pretty good because she's with them. They're all down the floor. Everybody's in the
somebody else from Johns Hopkins.
Things that were kidney problems. I never get to hear like I didn't know Mike was in was in the picture.
Can you get there? Okay, you're right.
Thank you. students was selected from a large and accomplished pool of applicants. Nearly 5,000 students applied for admission. Over 800 were interviewed. All were qualified for careers in medicine, but none as qualified this year. 170 students enrolled this year, include 127 in the university program, the 162nd year of this program, 32 in the Cleveland Clinic Lerner College of Medicine case, the second year of the program, and 11 in the MD PhD program, funded a case by a continuing grant from the National Institutes of Health. This is the 49th year of that program. The 170 students entering this year come from 76 different colleges and universities. The largest number, of course, from Case, with 25 students. Next, Duke and WashU, each with 6. UCLA, Cornell, and Northwestern with 5 each. Stanford, Harvard, and the University of Chicago sending 4 each. And Chicago, Dartmouth, and MIT, 3 each. 26% of this class hails from the state of Ohio. And of the remaining, California sent 24, Pennsylvania 9, Michigan and New York 8. In all, 32 states are represented, even though all 50 states were represented in the applicant pool. And your academic accomplishments and credentials are stunning, with MCAT scores and GPAs that place you at the highest level in the history of our school, far above the national average. 15 of our students grew up abroad. Almost all of you have had substantial research experience in college. 26 played intercollegiate athletics at the varsity level. Thank goodness we didn't have to compete with them for admission to Mothers and fathers, grandmothers and grandparents, sisters and brothers, family and friends, you have prepared them well. Let us now ask all of those individuals to rise so that all of us can recognize you. Please stand so we can thank you for having sent your sons and daughters. This medical school has been around for a very long time, over 160 years, and during that time it has achieved a number of distinctions. In 1910, when Abraham Flexner did his celebrated review of American medical schools, trashing most of them, he singled out Hopkins, Case Western, and Columbia P&S as models of great American medical schools. In 1953, Case Western inaugurated a new medical school curriculum that soon became the national model adopted by nearly every school in the nation. Case Western has nurtured the careers of numerous Nobel laureates in medicine, including most recently Paul Berg in 1994 for the complement DNA technology, and Fred Murat in 1998 for the biology of nitric oxide. The former Surgeon General David Satcher is a graduate of Case and has lent his name to one of our societies. And the current CDC director is Julie Gerberding. Just recently, the School of Medicine received a perfect accreditation score from the Liaison Committee on Medical Education, only the third time in the history of American medicine that has happened. That educational innovation and scientific excellence at Case continues. In research, the school is now ranked 13th national in NIH grant funding. Many of our individual departments among the top 10. In education, the university program will soon inaugurate a new curriculum, and this new class of entering university students will pioneer a new research thesis requirement for graduation. They are still stunned at the thought of it. In the midst of all this perfection and innovation, we should also recognize today that this year, like last year, for the very first time, 32 of our incoming students are part of the new medical school program, the Cleveland Clinic Lerner College of Medicine at Case Western Reserve. This collaboration with the Cleveland Clinic represents a bold new chapter in innovation here in Case, a new pathway in medical education that is already capturing the interest and imagination of medical schools across the country. In addition to recognizing the new students in the college program, let me recognize two remarkable efforts of the faculty who are projecting this program into national leadership. Let me ask Eric Topol to stand, one of the country's most celebrated physicians, provost of the college program, and Andy Fishleader, Andy, if you would please stand, its executive dean. Let me also acknowledge that Jeff Hutzler, formerly the associate dean for admissions, admitted these students to the college program, and I would now like to recognize the new associate dean for admissions in the college program, Kathy Franco, for whom we issue a warm welcome. Thank you to all three of you. I want to recognize, too, that this year's class of university program students are the first to be admitted by our new associate dean for admissions, Amy Hennigan. Amy, will you please rise? I'm going to also introduce Amy's colleague in this activity, assistant dean for admissions, Lena Newton. All of you out there, the brothers and sisters ready to follow in your footsteps, Amy and Lena will be lighting the path. Principal Kathy Franco, it is never too early to start the conversation with them. Let's get them here for the next group of Case medical students. Also here on the podium are several key individuals, Dr. Robert Daroff, formerly the chair of neurology at Case and vice dean for education, Dr. Robert Payne, Dr. Ken Smith, Ken's a senior associate dean of the Society, Dr. Melissa McKinley, head of the Emerald Dr. Steve Rickenmother, head of the Warren Society. We're also joined this morning by Dr. William Bruner, class of 1975, a distinguished ophthalmologist. Dr. Howard Nierman, class of 1976. This morning's ceremony welcomes these new students into our profession as our future colleagues. No one is better suited to represent our faculty in extending this morning's welcome than the next speaker, Dr. Robert Haney. Dr. Haney is an MD PhD graduate of Case, of the University and the Medical School. He is a visible, persistent, quirky, charismatic, inspiring presence, not just here at Case, but throughout our region and the country. He will address you this morning to welcome you into the Medical School of Case. And he's entitled his remarks, Reflections as a Student, Teacher, and parent. Let us welcome Dr. Robert Haney.
I was told to be brief, so I'll try to keep to within an hour. Thanks, Dean Horowitz, to my colleagues, to parents, and to the students. When I was asked to give this talk, I was going to sit down and write something, but I said, no, that's not my style. I knew Dr. Topol would be here, so I said, I'm going to speak with what's I'll put inside this white coat, and I'm going to speak from my heart. And by speaking from my heart, I think it's, I want to take you on a journey to the past 30 years of my experience here at this medical school, and the process of putting this white coat on and taking it off. And that's first off as a student. When I was in your position, we did not have a white coat ceremony, but we had a luncheon in which all the faculty and students were invited to sit down, break bread, and get to know one another. And I had my little name tag like you folks did. And a gentleman walked up to me and he says, Bob. I says, Fred. And where are you from, Bob? And I told him where I was from. And, you know, I've been in a graduate school. And nice Fred, where are you from? He said, he told me where he was from. It was Fred Robbins. Now, I felt like an idiot. Oh, a couple of days later, to find out that I called the dean Fred. But I felt good because that's what he had on his name tag, was Grand Rapids. Now, Dr. Rapids was special not only was he the dean, but he was also a Nobel Prize winner. And he won a Nobel Prize for his work in polio. And he got the prize in 1954. And you have to go back to the 50s, when I was a kid, to understand the impact that polio had on our community. It was such an impact that when we were going to bed at night and we said our prayers, after you said bless mom, dad, uncle Charlie, and everybody else, my mother would say, please do not let my child get polio. So when I came to Case West Reserve and met somebody who called himself Fred, Nobel Prize winner, who had taken polio out of our prayers, I had to tell you that. I also told my mom I met the person who took polio out of our prayers, and she wanted to meet him also. Well, what you have to understand is over the years, and I would sit down with Dr. Robbins, I could never call him Fred. You know, he'd say, Bob, this is Fred. I did that once. I'm not going to make a mistake again. He still came on Dr. Robbins. Well, approximately 2.5 years ago, when we decided to sit down and put together the society structure, I was asked, who would you like to name your society after? It only took a microsecond. And I said, it's Dr. Fred Robbins. So I called Dr. Robbins and asked him, would you allow us to use your name to honor you with respect to this society structure? And he says to me, two conditions. One, Bob, anything that you're affiliated with, you can use my name. The second thing he says, you've got to call me Fred. I said, okay, Fred. And I whispered, and 6 months later, he passed away. So, folks in the Robbins Society, I take it really deep and personal that we had somebody like Dean Robbins when I was a dean here, that he'd walk up to a student and call him Fred. The second thing is that as a faculty member, I was doing my report because I ran the internal medicine program at our hospital, and a resident comes in, who's a case grad. And he comes to the morning report, they better stay at the morning report. Depends on who's writing it. Sometimes it can be kind of a intense provoking. You're a little nervous that somebody's going to call on you and you don't know the answer. And this intern came with an emphasis facing. And I'm thinking, oh my gosh, this guy's really nervous. He's going to throw up in the morning report. And so after morning report, I said, what do you do with an emphasis facing? Because he did very well. He says, I was coughing up blood last night while I was on call. So I said, step into my office. I said, what? He said, I was coughing up blood. I said, that's a problem. And he says, yes, I have cystic fibrosis. And so I called his doctors over at Rainbow and asked, I says, your patient's coughing up blood. And he says, Bob, just go ahead and put him on aminoglycosides and treat him with aminoglycosides. And if he doesn't do well in the next 3 days, we'll be here at Rainbow Babies and Children's. So I called Will Birnbaum in, and I said, I'm supposed to give you 10 milligrams a kilo of gentamicin. Now, you'll learn about this down the road. That's a hefty dose of aminoglycoside in the vitamin doses. And I said, you don't need pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics to figure out if it's a proper dose or not, because when the levels are too high, it knocks out your hearing. When the levels, the peak levels knock out your hearing, the trough levels knock out your kidneys. So I used to tell the residents, if you can't hear yourself pee, you know that the pharmacokinetics is wrong right now. Or operating there. So I treated him with 10 milligrams per kilo of aminoglycoside in my office. He did well. And throughout the next 3 years, Will was able to complete his internal medicine residency on time. And what inspired me at the graduation ceremony for the residents was to come up with something called the postulates of Haney. There are 3 postulates of Haney, but you can only apply 2. Number 1, be a good doctor. Number 2, attempt to make a lot of money. Or number 3, have a family life. And so that was sort of in honor of Will Birnbaum. And most of my residents, when they see me down the road, says, I remember the postulates of Haney, but I never asked which 2. Subsequently, I ran into Will's parents at a function, and they told me he was critically ill, and he was waiting for a heart and lung transplant. And he subsequently died waiting for a heart and lung transplant. At that time, I instituted an award at our hospital to honor Will Birnbaum. as a resident who went above and beyond the call to me, and that award is still given today at University Hospitals. I invited the parents to the ceremony, the first Will Birnbaum ceremony, and afterwards I was talking to his mom and dad, and they said, Will would always say that, tell Dr. Haney that I think I chose the appropriate two positives of Haney. And she said, Will learned a lot of medicine working with you, Doc. And I said, he may have learned a lot of medicine from me, but I learned a lot about life working with Will Birnbaum. And I said, I paraphrase something Dr. King said. Dr. King says, you never judge a man when he stands in the sea of tranquility. You only judge him when he stands in the pathway of adversity. And I felt that really fit Will Birnbaum. Also, I didn't know I was going to run into these words again. Unfortunately, down the road, which is about 14 years ago, I got the ultimate phone call. And that was, my daughter was away on spring break in Atlanta. And I got a call from the hospital saying her daughter has been critically injured. So, you know, I'm trying to figure out how to go into Atlanta. You know, since I've tried, but no, I'm going to try to Atlanta. But I wanted to get the first thing out of town. So I get down to Atlanta, she's in the OR, the surgeon comes out, and he says, Dr. Haney, can I talk to you for a minute? I said, yeah. I said, what's given to the nature of her injuries? He says, critical. I said, it's critical. I said, it's critical. I says, well, give it a little down. He said, she's transected her liver. She was hit by a car. She's transected her liver. She's ruptured her hepatic vein. She's ruptured her inferior vena cava. And she's bleeding from the left chest. All of those injuries, either one can take them out. And he says that the likelihood of her pulling this out is remote. So I sat down and, you know, thought about all this white coat stuff. Forget the white coat. And I just sat there thinking, just a minute ago I had a kid. And now they're telling me my 19-year-old daughter is dying. And I've dealt with, you know, living and dying and the ramifications around that as a physician, but never, ever as a parent. And as the parents of prayer, please do not let me, anything happen to my children, let it be me first. So I was sitting there and tears rolling down my face. And a lady comes up to me and says, son, which made me feel good because when you got gray hair in your face, my son. She said, son, I can see you're in pain. I says, yes. She says, do you mind if I pray for you? No, ma'am, go for it. And she says, so she started to pray. You have to understand the South. In fact, this happened in the house, I think I told you. You know, very religious. And she put something in my hand, and I take what I carry in my white coat. She put something in my hand. This has been 14 years, and I still keep it in my pocket. She put this small cross in my hand, and that's what stays in my white coat. And she says, no matter what happens, you will be able to deal with this adversity. So, and then I found out that she had just lost her 16-year-old grandson. So here's a lady who had lost a 16-year-old grandson to trauma, and she's praying for Bob Haney. There was a picture that was in the surgical intensive care unit that I'd look at, and it was crooked. And I said, maybe if I go up there and straighten out the picture, she'll do better. Now, it really sounds crazy. You know, I'm trying to change the entropy in the room. So, crazy stuff. And when I went to do that, what's in my other pocket is words from a picture that I was going to straighten out. And these are the words from that picture. It says, Charles Lemon Dibble Boyle left his footprints on the sands of time, never to be washed away. They lead to the future and to others' futures beyond. Charles was only 3 years old when he died. His mother, Grace Dibble Boyle, and father, Gus Boyle, through their love, donated his organs so that others could have a chance to live. I read that, and I said, I went up to surgery, it was Pat Lee. I said, Pat, how's Tracy doing? I said, not good, boss. I said, Pat, when she goes, not if she goes, you can harvest her organs. He says, Bob, I said, you'll understand something. I want to make that decision now that she will become an organ donor. And it's my way of giving her some degree of immortality and my way of dealing with this tragedy. And I sit there and say that I told Will Birnbaum, you know, Judge Amand stands as your counsel at the Holman Catholic University. And I say that it applies to me. And so when I put this white coat on, to Fred, Will, the Bill kids, and Tracy, I think Bette Midler said it best. You are the wind beneath my wings. Thank you.
Sanjay Mather, David Madsen, Brandon Mong, Andrew McCoy, Michelle McGoy, Jennifer Monte, Lauren Moore, Jamin Morrison, Arian Moses, Aaron Nagy, Ravi Venkatesh, Jared Wachterman, Nolan Walther, Samuel Wiedes, Shoshana Weiner, Smith. Catherine Way. Ostranda Williams. Susan Williams. Robert Worka. June Shu.
Dr. Smith likes to say, looking out on this wonderful, wonderful site, Shazam! How did that happen? Will all the new students here at Casey, in your white coats, please stand and face your family and friends? Always the scariest moment for them to see. But I was absolutely thrilled by what I heard last year. I was enormously pleased by the effort that I saw in the footprints of this just a few days ago. I am looking forward to hearing for the first time the new Illicare professional compact for all the people in the room. Let me now call Dr. McKinley to lead my classes.
Four days ago, on the first day of orientation for the university program at the Case School of Medicine, all first-year students in the college program and the university programs met together for the first time. They were asked to break up and work with a small group of students who they didn't know, and to work through clinical cases that they'd never seen or ever had any experience with. And their task was to work together to identify those key attributes of being a physician that they felt were most important. And then to create a document stating these points to be read today to you, their family and friends and faculty. The class decided to create an oath and to strive to uphold it as they enter into the profession of medicine. Let me introduce student Dr. John Moffitt, who will lead his class in the recitation their oath of professionalism. Will the class of 2009 please stand?
Today, we begin.
Warmth and clarity, recognize their physical, social, and emotional health, and
welcomes you into the profession, and as you have just done, commits you willingly into the profession's contract with society. A contract that obliges you, as it does me and all of us, to always place the interests of our patients ahead of our self-interest. The social contract also demands that we set and maintain standards of competence, integrity, and provide that expert advice to society in matters of health. Essential to this contract is the public trust in physicians, which depends on the integrity of each and every individual physician, each and every one of you sitting here in this auditorium, indeed, each and every member of the profession of medicine throughout the country and the world. Regardless of where physicians live and work, the code of professional ethics that guides our behavior links us to traditions that have endured for over 2,500 years. The very code that we are now wearing is symbolic of that commitment. But the white coat is more than just a symbol. When you wear that white coat, you become someone different than you were before. When you wear your white coat, you become somewhat important to the people you care for. When you wear your white coat, patients allow you into their lives and tell you things that you would be astounded to hear. Things they would tell almost no one else because they trust you to take that information and use it for their benefit. Just like all the rest of us who continually grow into our white coats, you're going to have to make sure that it fits right. I notice we have some work to do with some of you. But it has to fit metaphorically as well as physically. You're going to have to trust yourself when you're wearing that white coat. You're going to have to keep the trust of your patients when you wear it as well. You will need to be the best educated doctor possible. It is our duty here as faculty to help you achieve that goal. You will need to question, to analyze, to always base your clinical decisions on evidence, and never forget that the difference between you and your white coat, a faith healer or a quack similarly attired, is that your decisions are based on data and science. You will grow into your white coat, you will advance our knowledge when you wear it in the laboratory, you will teach us when you wear it in the classroom and on the wards and in the offices as physicians. Your white coat will change shape as you change shape as the years pass. But whatever you're feeling when you put that coat on, I hope it gives you a sense of strength, a sense of pride. You will occasionally even be scared in that white coat. I can assure you the most frightening words I remember in the tournament. Always, Dr. Horowitz, we need you right now. You will confront real challenge with life and death in your white coat. You will take humility in you. You will take care of some of us in your white coat. Because when we are sick, we will be the ones who care for us. Your white coat is a gift from your faculty, but you will earn it the rest of your life. You will be accompanied throughout your journey in medicine by others in the profession who earn their white coats as well. I look forward to seeing each and every one of you, not only this afternoon at the reception, but in the days that follow, in the classroom, on the board, and in all the other places where medicine is learned and practiced. Here at Case, welcome to the profession. Students and the platform party will be going directly outdoors if weather permitting for a photo before attending the reception. Their family members may proceed to the reception area of the grand foyer in the Smith lobby, or if they have come prepared to take photos of their own, they are welcome to join us outside for that ceremony. This white coat is a celebration of this officially.